Residential. There are three different types of residential zoning designations in the development plans. One, the first category, is for the lower lying areas. So that's basically most, that's for existing residential areas. The second one is for the higher areas, so more the hillside locations. And then there is a third one, residential to be detailed, and that's for new residential areas, so areas that are currently still undeveloped or vacant. So I will now go into more detail about these different types. The first one, again, is for the lower-lying areas. No minimum lot size applies to these areas. There is a maximum building density, which is 40%, and the maximum building height is 10%. So it's still quite flexible, I would say, contrary to what was normally used with the planning permits. We don't say it has to be an apartment or a one-family dwelling. So it, as long as it fits within those parameters, it can be any type of dwelling, so to speak. Then for the second residential zoning designations, that is aimed at the higher areas, the hillside areas. There are some other building regulations to that based on the hillside policy. A minimum lot size will apply and also a maximum building density. And in this case, the maximum building height is slightly lower, it's 6.5 meters. The reason for that is basically that we would like to encourage a less dense type of development higher up in the hillsides, because development in the higher and especially the steep areas will require a lot more of excavation and also more build-up areas. It also means less water retention, less green, etc. So basically the building regulations are aimed at having a lower density the higher and the steeper you go, basically. And also for these areas, the construction of a cistern will be mandatory. And that has basically two reasons. One is that it is a water supply also in case of a disaster, for example. So you will also have a backup. And it is also, by that, a water retention. So all the water that falls on your roof goes in the cistern, and it decreased the runoff of water in the hillside areas as well. Then the third one is residential to be detailed. That's for the larger areas that are not yet built, that do not have an existing planning permit, but that may be developed in the future. So for your information, there are also some existing planning permits which are already approved. And some of the areas are not yet fully developed, but those don't have the residential to be detailed areas, while in reality they still look vacant. They already have approved planning permissions, so those are always taken into account and incorporated in the zoning plans. So for the areas that are not yet built and also do not have a planning permit, those have the residential to be detailed zoning designation, and the developer we'll have to make a subdivision plan based on certain criteria, based on the zoning plan, in terms of access, how you are going to address water management, how the subdivision will be, etc. And that will need approval for those areas. Then some general regulations for the residential areas. I mentioned before already, all types of residential use are allowed. For example, I mentioned the planning permit, but also sometimes in deeds, it's very strict with one-family dwelling, but there is a great demand on St. Maarten, for example, to build an apartment down your house or something like that. So that, in principle, will be allowed by means of the residential zoning designations, as long as you stay within the maximum building height, you take the setbacks into account, etc. So the residential areas are strictly for residential use, with the exception of so-called home-based occupation. So, for example, an architect or small administration office that will fit within a residential use. There will also be parking regulations. For residential, it is one space for a dwelling and one for each extra two bedrooms. And as I mentioned also already before, the existing rights, so existing building permits and existing planning permits, we try to all incorporate them in the zoning plans because those are already existing rights. This is just an overview of all the residential areas in Dutch Quarter and Middle Region. Maybe it will not be, you will not be able to see it in detail. That's why we have the maps in the back as well, so you can have a closer look at the end of the presentation. The other objective is to encourage the so-called village centers within the neighborhoods. The village center is basically a concentration of a bundling of different functions, public functions, but also a nice playground, shops, etc. It has different reasons. It can stimulate social cohesion, and it will also limit traffic movements if you have all the functions in one area combined. And those village centers are facilitated in a zoning plan within a center or social zoning designation. So some of the possible locations in Dutch Quarter are the area where we are right now, so where you already have, for example, close by a playground, a church, community center, etc. And then there is another community center and a playfield here in the Dutch Quarter. So those are areas that are already sort of function and could be further developed into real village centers. And also in Middle Region, there are some potential locations. For example, here by the Middle Region road is here. Here's where the school is. And the other one is here in Rice Hill. Well, and other social zoning designations that you will find on the map are those for sports and also the green areas for parks, which you find the two in the Bethlehem area, and where also a secondary school will be possible. And as I just explained, also the cemeteries are running out of space on St. Maarten. And we thought that the Quarter and Middle Region area, where there is no cemetery currently, could potentially also that it could also be a potential use. But the location, we do not yet know it, because that is also something, of course, that has to be researched, and of course, landowners would also have to agree on that. Our government would have to buy a piece of property for that. So within the zoning plan, we just have a general regulation that a cemetery can be allowed if certain criteria are met. For example, it is not allowed to be too close to a residential area. There has to be proper access, parking, etc. So in those cases, if those criteria are met, and government can make an agreement with the landowner, then possibly it can be facilitated within the Dutch Quarter or Middle Region areas, but it could also be possibly another plan area. But yeah, the point basically is that it is needed somewhere. Then the next topic, agriculture. Now, the objective both for the spatial development strategy and also for these zoning plans is to facilitate and encourage small-scale agriculture. Not necessarily small scale, but we aiming mostly on that, because most areas on St. Maarten are already quite developed, but there are also quite some smaller vacant lot in betweens that could be used for agriculture. So we facilitate the agricultural use in terms of zoning, but on the other hand, we do not rule out possible other use later on. So for example, in a residential area, if a lot is not being used for a long time, it can be used for agriculture, and then maybe 5-10 years later, it can still get a residential function. So we try to be flexible with it. So the agriculture is in principle allowed within every zoning designation. For livestock farming, an exemption has to be granted because that can have some more effects on the residential areas in terms of nuisance. So that must not have too much effects on the residential areas. So that would require an exemption from the Ministry of Farm. The next topic is nature, landscape and water. The objectives from the spatial development strategy are to preserve the higher and or steep slopes of the hillsides. This is also based as well on the hillside policy, and also to establish the nature park for the ecological most important and undisturbed areas. In terms of water management, stormwater management, the objectives is to have more attention for stormwater management, for water runoff, by regulating development, and this that does not necessarily mean that development cannot take place, but at least you better have to take the runoff of water better into account, and especially also the natural gutters which you have in the areas. The objectives for Dutch Quarter and Middle Region are basically quite similar. It's also the preservation of the higher slopes, the higher green hills, and attention for stormwater management, also the natural gutters and the flood-prone areas. So the green hills in the areas, they have a high scenic value and also an ecological value, so a value for nature, and they are also an important buffer of rainwater, and thereby they also prevent erosion. So that's why some of the higher slopes of the green hills are zoned as nature area, where in principle no development can be allowed. So they are partly within the areas of Dutch Quarter and Middle Region as well, was mostly also within the adjacent plan areas. For example, the one especially for the higher hills is the one for hillside conservation areas. And in terms of water management, that is really a transboundary issue. It is because the water runoff doesn't stop at the border, and actually in Dutch Quarter and French Quarter, that's the largest catchment area of rainwater, which is joined by the French and the Dutch sides. So the more that is being developed in Dutch Quarter will also cause problems in French Quarter, because that's where the water runoff eventually will go. So that's also why we need attention for stormwater management, to have better water retention, and also in terms of the low-lying areas, which you have, for example, here in Belvedere as well, to have some regulations in order that the buildings are built flood-proof. So the new larger developments for the residential to be detailed area that I just explained, they will require a plan for stormwater management. There has to be attention for water retention, so basically to hold the water in the area for a certain period, and for example that you do not build in natural gutters, or at least if if you build in that area, it has to be addressed how the stream is going to be diverted and that it does not cause too much of a problem for the lower lying areas. There are also regulations for the flood-prone areas. That is what is meant with flood-proof building. And those are the minimum elevation for the ground floor or the living area. So as you can see on the map here, it's the blue lines. And for instance, they say 0.5. So the main floor, the ground floor level, has to be half a meter above grade. And as you see by a lot of old historic buildings, that's how in the past people always built, because in terms you can never prevent flooding or hurricane or whatsoever. So it's also important to take that into account. And then you can see on the map also the double zoning designation, water management for the natural gutters. And again, that doesn't mean that you cannot build at all in those areas, but at least you would have to show how you are going to properly address the issue of water management within the development. And again, the last main topic of the presentation, cultural history and archaeology. The objections for both the spatial development strategy and the zoning plans are the projecting of the potentially present artifacts within the areas by conducting research prior to development of areas which has a high expectation of those artifacts being present, and also to enable or encourage what is called preservation-driven developments of monuments. So this may sound a little bit abstract, but I will try to explain it a little bit better. There are in the area some designated monuments. They are in fact already protected by means of the monument ordinance. So for example, the Union Farm Estate House, which is one of the oldest, or even the oldest, I think, stone buildings on Sint Maarten. So that building is already protected, and it is marked on the map with a little star, but that's more of an awareness function. So the Union Farmhouse is one, the other protected monuments in the areas are the Belvedere and Bethlehem areas. So what is meant with the preservation-driven development? That is that with the development plans, we make new potential use possible for those areas, because that would also be required in order to actually maintain or either improve the areas. Because, for example, if you have just a monument and you can't do anything without it, then, yeah, what you see on a lot of other locations, the monuments just start falling apart. So with the zoning plans, we try to find a balance where we allow developments which facilitates those areas to be properly restored, and also give them a certain type of use. So for example, as I mentioned more in the beginning of the presentation, for the Belvedere Estates, there is a planned historical theme park that will be facilitated in terms of zoning. And for the areas that doesn't have the monumental structures, so more this side, for example, a golf course could be created. So this is more the southern side of the Belvedere Estate along the Bishop Hill Road, and that is where the actual monumental structures are. So the idea is that a historical park will be created to have a nice surroundings, but also a visitor center with a restaurant, for example. So it can also be sort of a new attraction for tourists as well. And that enables also to finance the restoration of the monuments and to make a nice surrounding of that area, to give it a good type of use that fits within the cultural historic character of the area. Then for the areas with a high expectation of artifacts or other archaeological subjects being present, those have a double zoning designation for those value. For those areas, development might only be allowed if the archaeological value is not at stake. That means that prior to development, some evaluation, some research has to be done by a specialist from FOMI and in first instance, and some further research might be required on that based on the first inventory. And it is basically a flexible zoning designation, so to speak, because it's an expectation of artifacts or other things being present, but we don't know for sure. So for example, if research has been done and it was found that nothing was present, then that double zoning designation can be taken off the map. So again, this is also not really something to hamper the development, but at least to make sure that all the artifacts, etc., are saved and documented, etc. I would like to finalize with some general remarks and with the draft maps. There might be, within the zoning plan, situations where the existing use, so either the building or the type of use, is different from what is allowed based on the zoning plans. Those situations can be maintained, because then we speak of existing right, but that's only the case if it was legally there and if it was there already before the publication of the draft development plan. Then this is an example of our government website with which have a directory with zoning development plans where you can find more information as well. And it has a map which indicates the 13 different areas. So that's the zoning area. Then you will find the Dutch Quarter and Middle Region areas. And on this website, we will also upload this presentation, and the plans that will later will be put on public review will also be published online on the government website. So these are the preliminary draft maps. Again, it's probably too small to read, especially in the back, so you could have a closer look later on. That's Quarter and the Middle Region area. So what is next? Well, the next step in the process will be the placement of the both draft plans, so the one for Dutch Quarter and Middle Region, on public review. That will be done, I think, in a matter of weeks, but that will also be it will also be made, you will be made aware through the newspaper as well as the government website. And then the plans will be placed on public review for a period of 30 days. And then everyone can give his formal written reaction to the Minister of FOMI. So that will be announced through the media. So stay tuned on that.
It's a long process, and I find it my responsibility and the responsibility of the ministry to at least finalize that process and bring it to the elected officials in parliament to make a decision on that. Number two, the plan was presented, it's a draft. We're here to get feedback from you all. Because again, it's not only government together with the community, together we have to do this. And then comments, we don't want government in here. But then later on, you're complaining that government is not coming here to do certain things. So we can't have it both ways. We're going to do this together. And by saying doing it together, I mean the community together with government, we're going to do it. One of the things with the zoning plans where we indicate land reservations where you say here's garage is allowed, here residential is allowed, then it's clear for everyone. If there's a garage under the tree, you see the zoning map, you know exactly that is a legal structure, then it's clear for everyone. And you then can indicate to government, look the zoning plan, this is a residential area, a garage is not allowed. And government can then enforce. Now we have a gray area. And this is what we're trying to avoid, the gray area that is clear for you, it's clear for government, what is allowed, and that is what the zoning plan is about. It's not about bringing hardship on people, it's about bringing clarity to everyone, to government and to the residents. That if something is happening under the tree, you're complaining about the containers and so forth, then it's clear. Then we know by the zoning plan, this is an illegal structure, this is not what is intended in the zoning plan, and government could take actions, and then you could hold government accountable for that. So again, this is not about elections. I'm not on a list. I work for Vuamy, I grew up in St. Martin, and I think it's about time that we start to structure things on this island. And the mushroom, the illegal things happening all the time. Sometimes it looks like a banana republic. Everything, what is happening is like people turning a blind eye to it. And this is one of the processes we have to follow. It's prescribed by law. And my job here is I want to do that part, and then we leave it up to Parliament, and then you could hold them accountable. Because they're the one who have to make the final decision.